So I think we are officially live. Welcome, everybody. Thank you so much for joining us. Before we really get started today, I just want, of course, let everyone know that we are live here on Facebook as well as on YouTube. So if you have any comments you want to be mentioning throughout this stream, you know, of course, put them in the comment section below and we'll be happy to answer, you know, whatever ones you put down there. And, you know, today we really were trying to think of something to Thunder really hit at, something that we could really go after. And we kind of had we were trying to go with about two goals that we could really set when we were trying to set up this live stream today. And so, you know, one of the things that we were really thinking about is, of course, something that you can take with you today, right? Something that once you get done listening to this live stream, you can implement in your life right then and there and start seeing those results just about instantly, right? Something that can actually be utilized right then and there, whether it be in your personal life or your professional life, however you want to utilize it. And the second thing we wanted to have is something that we could allow you to be able to take a next step in. So if you really enjoy what you hear today, and in a little bit we'll be talking about something that we have available that I really think you'll probably really be interested in, something that we're really excited to announce that will really allow you to really delve even deeper into a lot of these topics. So, and what we'll be really talking today, I'm pretty sure you've already seen it in the title here, is this importance of influence, right? I mean... Now, before we really delve too much into it, I really want you to think back, really think back to the past. And do you really recall, like, you know, those times when your parents would tell you to stay away from certain people because they were a bad influence on you? Or not to go to certain places because, you know, you want to avoid potential problems. You know, the places we go, the things that we do, the people who, you know, the people in our lives influence who we are. You know, what we do and the results that we end up getting. You know, these things happen daily that have some level of influence on us. Now, along, of course, with actions and words influencing us, each of us also possesses that same power to influence others through our actions and our words. You know, one very simple form of influence is something you probably do daily, and that is just smile. You know, when you walk up to someone or you pass someone on the street, just, you know, kind of smile and nod your head, of course, they typically will smile and nod their head back. You know, saying hi to someone will influence them to say hi back. And of course, on the opposite end, if you want to berate someone and just be angry with someone, it's going to get an angry and hostile response back at you as well. It really doesn't matter what situation or event that it is. Influence really plays at some point, you know, just in every day of our lives. Now, before I get too much into weeds with all of this, I do, of course, want to introduce who's always with me here today, Stacy Barnes and, of course, Billy Nail. How are y'all doing?
Fantastic.
Doing great. Excited to be here.
All right. Fantastic. Now, Stacy, I know this Sunday you definitely talk about quite a bit in a lot of the work you do, of course, when it comes to influence, because obviously, you know, you're working with a lot of different business owners out there and obviously trying to, I guess that's going to be more in the realm of the professional, right, where you're trying to influence people on the personal level. So first, I kind of want to ask you a quick question before we really delve too much into a lot of the philosophy around influence and just, you know, what is influence? How would you describe influence?
So we've titled this Learning to Become a Person of Influence, and becoming a person of influence is incredibly important for our success. And it's quite simple because, as we have learned from our mentor, John Maxwell, he's the first that I heard who gave this definition of leadership. Leadership is influence, nothing more, nothing less. So if we want to become better leaders in our homes, better leaders in our communities, better leaders in our businesses, if we're going to be better leaders, we have to have a greater ability to influence others. And so we're basing this off of the book. And James, you've got your copy of the book there, because with my green screen, mine won't show up very well. But if you've got it handy, hold it up. But we're going to be going through Becoming a Person of Influence. And it is by John Maxwell. There we go. And we had planned on starting a mastermind on Monday, and we had circumstances come up that didn't allow that to happen. So we're going to be telling you how to get back in onto the mastermind, which we're now going to be starting up in March. So more to come on that later. But it's a great book. And really what we're trying to do is just increase our ability and our skills as a leader. And we're going to do that by influencing people, influencing others. Anything to add, Billy?
No, I think you said it right on. And, you know, that's exactly what we're going to be talking about is really influence is the ability to lead. And the greater our level of influence, the better leaders we will be and the more people we will be able to lead. And that's why being able to influence people is so, so important. And that's why relationships are so important. And so I'm excited about the mastermind that's coming up. But tonight we're going to kind of just, like you said, we're going to introduce this because everybody, you know, everybody influences somebody. We understand that, you know, we're even right now, we have people that are looking up to us. The question is, how are we going to influence them? And how are we going to take our influence to the next level? That's what we're going to be talking about a little bit tonight, and then in more detail in the mastermind that's coming up next month.
Yeah. And so a lot of the things in the book and a lot of things that we talked about, you're probably going to think, well, you know, I've heard that before. And as a matter of fact, John Maxwell was doing an interview at one point, and it was about a different book, but the interviewer was kind of trying to stick it to him a little bit. And he said, you know, all the things in this book, they seem quite simple. And John kind of laughed and he says, well, you know, a lot of the most important things in life are the simple things. And so once we've learned the basics, then maybe we can start to do some other things, but we got to get the basics done right first. And this is really one of the core tenets, one of the real basics of things that we've got to learn is to how can we influence better. And so the things in this book are very impactful. So if you get that feeling where you're like, you know what, I think I've heard some of this before, stop, think about it a little harder and say, am I as good at this as maybe I think I am, because we all have room for improvement here. But, you know, you were talking about, you know, it's influencing others in every realm. And so, James, you've kind of been experiencing this lately with my grandson. He's not even a year old yet. Can you tell that just simple things are already influencing him that you do?
Oh, definitely. And before I even mentioned that, you know, you said right there, you know, I've heard this before, but how are you actually doing it? Real quick, how many times have you told me something very simple and it took me probably years to finally start putting it into action?
Yeah. I'm in a good mood now. Don't take me back to those days.
Hey, but you know, the truth is, we learn from repetition. I mean, you know, we have to hear it over and over. We, you know, we feel like we have to tell it to our kids 1,000 times, but I'll be honest with you, as adults, we have to hear it over and over too.
Well, and more importantly, we have to hear it over and over, but a lot of times if we can just see it, we'll catch on a whole lot quicker.
So modeling these
behaviors is really where it's all at for being a really strong leader. And that's kind of what I think you're probably seeing some already, right, James?
Yeah, so it's really funny because I think I've discovered a lot of my own bad habits because I now am influencing in some way, of course, my kid. So, you know, my son's only about, around 9 months now, soon to be probably around 10 months here coming up. And the funny thing's happening where, of course, he's at age now where he's crawling around a lot. He's trying to stand up, and he's also trying to grab and do whatever it is me and his mom are doing. And the scary part about that is how much he loves to grab our phones. So every time he gets a chance, you can put him in front of all the toys we have, and in the center of all those toys or behind all those toys, you put one of our phones. He will go through all those toys, grab the phone, and just hold it up and look at it. And I'm like, okay, this is a bad habit. Clearly, me and his mom are on our phones way too much, right? It means that we really need to, you know, probably work on how much we're on our phone. Now, admittedly, sometimes we're doing stuff like video calling y'all so that y'all can actually see him. And so maybe there's some association there too. But yeah, it has allowed us to realize some of our own shortcomings and what we're doing through our day. So an interesting thing did happen recently. You know, you mentioned the book study that we're going to be doing here coming up. And because of that, of course, I've been going back through the book, right? And I was in his room. I was reading the book and He has this habit of going to his bookshelf and just kind of ripping stuff out and walking away or kind of crawling away. But instead, what he seems to be doing now is he's now going up to that bookshelf after only a week of me sitting down just kind of reading a book whenever I was with him. And he pulls out one book And he's not, of course, he's not really reading it, but he's just picking up and holding it and just slamming it to the ground repeatedly, just like, and like looking at me all happy and like, hey, look, I got a book too. So it really is amazing the importance of modeling that behavior, of course, because, you know, at the end of the day, the only people who we can really influence, or the only way we're going to influence is how we act in our own personal lives. And it comes down to, of course, the smallest of things, whether it be how much I'm on my phone versus how much I'm reading a book. The very little things can make a massive difference in the long haul.
So yep. if we think through this, whenever we do this and do the trainings around this in big groups, we always ask the question, you know, think back to a person who had a really great amount of influence on you. So if you could have one or two people in your life through your life, who are the ones that had the greatest influence? And invariably, it comes down to a parent, a grandparent, a sibling, a brother-in-law, or a friend. You know, almost never is it my boss or someone who has a position above you in a working relationship. It's rare that that's the case. And yet, if we were to go to the dictionary, you would think that the entire definition of leadership is based around a title or a position or something like that. But the people who influence us the most generally are going to be the friends and family relations and those that are in that circle of five people with whom we spend the most time. And so what we have to start doing is how can we take understanding that and then applying it and acting maybe a little bit different in our work life to get better results, better connections. Because, you know, we don't want to use this to manipulate anyone. We just want to be able to dig that deeper connection with the people that we work with so that we can all accomplish more together. So when you were thinking through that, and Billy, I'll come to you on this one. Has that been what you found as you go around teaching it, that usually people are more influenced by that close circle?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. People have to see what you do. You know, people hear what you say, but people will do what you do. And it is that close relationship, building a strong relationship, building a loving relationship, a caring relationship. When people know that you care for them, people know that you love them. As a matter of fact, I taught this tonight in our Bible study class at church just a few minutes ago. We're going through the book of Proverbs, and one of the things we're talking about is relationships. And one of the things that Solomon teaches in Proverbs is that if we're going to get anywhere in life, it's going to be through relationships. And so the key to influence is building strong relationships. And so you have to do that in a smaller group. You have to do that, you know, in a more intimate setting. And but as we grow in our influence and leadership ability, the more people that we can influence. But you know, you're right about a lot of people think that, well, once I get the position, then I can influence people. But that's not true. Matter of fact, Maxwell talks about the fact that if you try to lead by position, you're actually lead at the very lowest level. That is the lowest and the poorest level of trying to influence people. And the thing about it is, if you say, well, you know what, when I get the position, then I'll learn how to lead, or then I'll learn how to influence. But here's the problem with that. Once you get the position, you only have a small amount of time. There's just a small little gap that people are watching you. And if you cannot influence, if you cannot lead, then they're not going to follow, and they're going to see that. That's going to come through. So if you really want to be a good influencer, once you get the position, you got to start learning how to influence now. You can't wait till you get the position. You need to start now to learn how to lead, and learning what influence really is and how to influence others, so that when you get the position, you're off to a good start. Does that make sense?
Yeah, and once the plaque goes on the door, it may be too late if we're not careful. So yeah, we have to plan ahead. And the exercise that I always love doing when it comes to this idea of who do we influence is, so if you're listening to me right now, get a piece of paper, and on that piece of paper, draw a circle, and draw a fairly big circle on your piece of paper. And in the center of that circle, draw another circle, a smaller circle in the center. And in the smaller circle, just write the letters ME, because that's me. So that the center circle is you. So when it comes to leadership, we're going to start on the inside first. It has to start with me. And that's kind of what you're getting to there, is we have to do the work ahead of time to be prepared to have the skills, the knowledge, and everything that we need to be the best leader and the best influencer we can possibly be. So when we start with that circle, we're the first person we have to influence. Now, the way we influence ourselves is with very intentional action. It's with what we read. It's with who, with whom we hang out. It's with what we allow to go inside of our brains, with what we watch on TV, what we watch on our phones, and everywhere else that we have available to watch stuff these days. We have to be very careful with what we're putting in there. We have to lead and influence ourselves first. Now, from that center circle, that's me, draw an arrow that points down. So this is like the compass. This is called the leadership compass. So point it to the south. And that arrow that points down, that is leading people that report up to you. So if you've got a leadership position somewhere and there are people that look to you for guidance, that is your positional leadership. There are people who maybe you are responsible for their check, or at the very least, you're responsible for their for their key results to determine whether they're going to get paid more or something like that. Now, that's what we said is the absolute lowest level of leadership, because the reason they're following you at that level is because you wield some sort of power over them, whether it's the paycheck or the quarterly review or whatever it may be. So it is important that you have a proper relationship at this level, so that you're not just leading from a position of power, but you're leading from a position of relation, a position of a team that you've built that's going to work together to accomplish something greater than you either or any could do on your own. So we don't want to take that positional leadership for granted. Just like you said earlier, we want to make sure we prepare for that and we're the absolute best leaders we can be. Now, from the south, so that was the arrow pointing south. Now draw arrows pointing east and west, and that's going to be leading your peers, because we lead ourselves, we lead the people that report to us. We also lead our peers who, if you looked at an organizational chart, they'd be on the same level that you are. But it's really important. And you might think, well, you know, they're leading, doing their own thing. I'm leading, doing my own thing. What am I going to do to lead them? Well, what we're going to do to lead them is we're going to be the absolute best support that we can. We're going to share information, what's working, what isn't working. We're going to learn from them and learn together with them. And we're going to do what we can to help them grow and become the best leaders they can be. Leadership is really about people. Management is about systems and processes. Leadership is about people. And so at the peer level, we just want to make sure that we have the proper relations here, that the trust that we can build, so that we can all build something bigger together again than what we could do on our own. And so if we get siloed and you're just focused on your one little area and not going out and helping support and lead and work with the peers, you're not going to be as successful as a team as you could be. And the final arrow is the one pointing up. And we all also lead and influence our influencers. So the people to whom we report, the people who really have the biggest amount of influence on us, we have to influence them as well. And you might say, well, how do I lead my boss? Well, number one, you do a much better job at leading yourself, so that you have the ability to go to your boss or to your influencer and offer assistance. What can I see that you have these things going on? What if I took this, this, and this? I'll run with that, and that'll free up your time to work on this instead. What if we just went and offered some additional assistance? What if we went with ideas instead of just taking problems? One of the hardest things about being a leader in a business is you find yourself thinking for everybody sometimes. So what if you, as an independent thinker, went up that chart and says, you know what? I'm thinking, and I'm going to help think for you for a change. Let's do something big here. So we lead in every one of these different directions. So when the question comes up, who do we influence? Man, we influence everyone. So even within our business, it's everyone at every level. Within our families, it's everyone, regardless of who it is inside the family, with people we meet. James, you said if you smile on the street, people will smile back. Even in some of the places we've been that are not known to be the nicest cities in the world, we go and we're our normal selves and we tend to get along with just about everybody, because you smile, a lot of times people just will smile back. So we influence everybody. We're going to get to a stat later on. The average person nowadays has influence over about 10,000 people in a lifetime. And it's absolutely astounding. So the question of who do we influence, man, it's yes. You know, it's, yeah, it's like everybody. Yeah. But what do you guys have to add to that? That was my compass example.
Yeah, you know, that is so true. I love, and I think this was Maxwell who said this, but I love the quote, and I actually shared this tonight as well, and I shared this past Sunday in church. But I shared the fact that you need to talk about who we influence and how relationships are so important. But I said, you know, with the exception of one significant individual, the whole world is made up of others.
Yeah.
You know, and that is so true. And that's why these relationships are so important. And that's why we have to have strong relationships to influence people. And so therefore, it cannot be positional. And here's the thing, you mentioned that when we talk about the horizontal, the peer influence, and some people will say, well, you know, why do I need to learn and grow in my leadership and influence with my peers? Because, you know, some of them may think we're kind of in competition anyway, you know, with one another. But here's the thing. There may come a day when maybe you get promoted and all of a sudden now you're the supervisor of those peers. You cannot wait until that happens to become a good influencer. If you are a good influencer while you're on that level with them, when you get the position, they're going to much more be ready to follow you because they've seen that you have the ability to lead, the ability to influence. I had an interesting conversation the other day. I went of our county human resources personnel, and one of them was discussing with me a problem they were having in their organization of people who were being promoted to manager positions, to, you know, a little higher position. But the problem was it was creating conflict with the ones who were their peers, but now he's the boss or they're the boss, because now they're trying to micromanage. They're trying to lead by position. They're trying to lead by intimidation instead of really influencing them. And so, you know, it's really about building those relationships and starting now. Don't wait till you get the position. And so, yeah, I think that's right on. I think the leadership compass was a great illustration for defining that.
I think the number is about 90% of anything we accomplish in our life is going to be dependent in some way on other people.
That's right. Exactly right.
And I think it also goes to show just the importance of, you know, having that integrity with that influence, right? You know, we talk about it being at the smallest level, and even before you're at that before you're actually into that position of what traditionally would be deemed leadership, you know, having that integrity at the lower level, what would be deemed the lower level, while you're building up that influence before you take on that higher position, that's really what's going to make the big difference, right? Because, you know, people know your faults, right? Everyone knows your faults from the get-go. And so if you don't go ahead and start with your best foot prior, before you take those higher positions like that, people are going to already know all those issues that you had. If you sit there and you slack off prior to getting that promotion, everyone who's now working underneath you knows that you're pretty much a slacker. You can try to fake it all you want. There, it's going to be harder to build up that influence going from there.
Well, you've lost the trust. You've lost that emotional bank account of trust.
Yeah, that's exactly right. And the fact is, if people can't trust you, they won't follow you. And that's really, you have to build up a trust bank. Who was it? Was it Bob Berg who said people want to do business with or want to work with people they know, like, and trust? You know, and that's the thing. Do they know you? Have you built a relationship with them? Do they like you? You know, do you like one another? Do they like you? And then they wonder, can they trust you? And really, at the end of the day, they're going to be asking another question. That is, do you really care for me? And if they like you, know you, trust you, and know that you care for them, I mean, they'll follow you up the mountain.
Not only will they follow you, they'll also, in many ways, forgive you when you do make a mistake, because we're all going to make mistakes.
Absolutely.
In positions, all, you know, it happens to everyone. And if people are already, in a way, loyal to you in the sense of, you know, they trust you because you've built up that relation over time, they're willing to forgive those mistakes you make because they know who you are as a person. They know where you're still going to. They know you weren't trying to, you know, in a way, screw them over or screw them out of like a position or anything like that. They know that when mistakes get made, it wasn't intentional. It wasn't, you know, aimed at them or anything like that. They understand what you're going through in a much deeper way. And so it goes beyond just the idea of being able to lead them further. It also goes in the idea of, you know, when you get to that position where you might falter, you're going to need people around you who can also assist you and help you up as well. And that's what building that, you know, group of people that, you know, having that influence around a group of people like that can really help do as well.
Yep. Yeah, it's that trust bank account that Maxwell talks about. Every day for each time you're doing good, you put a coin in the trust account, and hopefully when something goes a little sideways, you've got enough coins that you don't lose all of your money from that trust bank account. Right? And you don't lose all of your trust.
I mean, I think many of us have seen cases where maybe someone that we were working with, I've told some people who, you know, during training sometimes, that, you know, if you make a mistake with a client, it's much easier if you've already built up that relationship from the get-go. It's why it's so important to do something as simple as, you know, just, you know, when we were doing trainings, you know, open the door for them, greet them, have a good smile on your face, have that good interaction with them to make sure that, you know, of course, we don't want mistakes being made, but when that mistake gets made, it won't ruin that relationship with that client as well. So it really does make a massive impact in just so many other aspects going forward.
Yeah, that's exactly right. And it goes back to what Stacy said earlier. And he's absolutely right. You know, it's leadership is all about people, and people is all about relationships. And if you have a strong relationship with people, they are more willing to forgive you. If they know that, hey, you know what, this person cares for me, again, this person trusts me. When we do mess up, they're more willing to forgive, especially if you admit, hey, I messed up. And they see that, and that's how you build those relationships, and that's how you influence people, because people will trust leaders who know their faults and admit their faults and say, yeah, you know what, I messed up here, you know, this is my fault, this one's on me, let's fix this and let's move on. And
a lot of people have the habit of trying to like hide some of those faults sometimes. And it's like, who are you fooling? Like, you know, the faults of your boss. And guess what? The people who are beneath you. And again, when I use the term beneath, I don't actually truly mean it. Because let's face it, a lot of times it's the people who are, you know, in positions that are lower than us that are really doing a lot of that heavy lifting. But, you know, just structurally speaking, the people who are beneath you, let's face it, they know your faults already. They're around you a lot. Like, you're the one who's instructing kind of the way things need to be going. They understand what your faults are already. So if you don't admit to them, that just is going to be another mark against you. You got to be, you know, open to the people around you. Because if you really do want to build that relation with them and have that influence, you know, being open and being somewhat vulnerable in that fashion does go a long way. Now, you know, we're talking about, you know, some of the ways that this positive, you know, a lot of ways this is positive. But let's face it, you know, influence, we can make mistakes and instead influence people in the other way. You know, I said at the beginning, you know, if you sit there and just scream at someone, you're going to influence them into anger, right? And so I guess it's kind of an open question for either of you. Obviously, without listing any names or anything, have you really seen cases where maybe working with someone or talking with someone and you saw that, you know, they might have thought they had good leadership skills and good influence over the people they were working with, but it was pretty clear what they were really doing is having a more negative influence on all those around them.
No, it happens all the time, and you can see it pretty much anywhere you look. So whether it's in, again, we can look at church leadership, we can look at political leadership, we can look at business leadership, you see it all the time. And what it comes down to is that leadership by position too often ends up being leadership my way or the highway type of command leadership. And then that turns into micromanagement. And if you really want people to do exactly the opposite of what you want them to do, try telling them exactly what to do. it just doesn't work. Leadership is not, that's just not what good leadership is. And so if it's that my way or the highway, number one, it stunts your ability to build the relationship with others. But even worse than that, it stunts your creativity of your entire organization, because now you've got a culture of people who are unwilling to come up with new ideas because they just know that you're already going to shut them down. So what they're going to do is they're going to do the least amount possible that they can do to still get a paycheck and not lose the job. And you're going to get to think for everyone because of just a poor leadership technique.
Yeah, that's exactly right. I've seen that happen. I've seen leaders who lead from position, who lead from intimidation, and that my way or the highway. And you're exactly right. It really does shut down people's creativity, or at least people coming and saying, "I have this idea," because every time they've done that in the past, they've been shut down. They've been closed out. Say, nope, this is my way. It's my way, the highway. And so they stop. And here's the sad thing about that is they stop growing themselves. And the very thing that leadership does is to help others grow to be their best. But when you lead from position, you're actually doing just the opposite. You're stunting somebody else's growth. And very poor leadership.
And a lot of new leaders fall into this, and just because they've gone from a position where they were doing the job and doing everything, and then they get put in a position of leadership because either they were doing the best job or maybe they're the person with the most experience or whatever. And so they continue to try to do everything. And so when somebody comes up to them with a question, instead of leading and guiding and coaching that person, they just do it. They just answer it. They just take over, and they never grow a team around them. They're just on their own. And what's Maxwell say? If you get to the top of the mountain, you weren't leading anything. You were on a hike, right?
Yeah. So nobody's following you.
If nobody is there with you in the hard times, if you're in the middle of a big project at work and you've got your whole team that would be available for you, and yet you find yourself the one at late at night still working, you're not leading anything, and there's some work to be done. And just before you get into this, leading by command, the way we're talking about now, is one of about seven different ways that we can influence others. This is obviously not the best way. As we dig into the mastermind, we get to dig into all 10 chapters of the book. We get to have discussions with the group that joins us, and we'll get into all of the different ways. But tonight, since we're limited on time, we picked this one because it just kind of illustrates our point of really what this is all about, probably as good as anything we could have done. So that's why we chose this one.
Also worth mentioning the fact of, you know, leading in that style, it doesn't just make it more difficult just to lead in general. It also makes it just more, it can create resentment towards you from your own employees, in which, if you're talking about a more professional sense. And I think many of us have seen it where, you know, a manager might be there that, you know, a lot of people don't like. And what happens? Everyone starts slacking off. People start trying to find ways to get back almost at their manager for their poor leadership, right? And it sounds kind of silly, but I've seen people do something as simple as, oh, well, I'm going to take a longer bathroom break just because, you know, don't care about that guy, right? I've seen people do a lot of petty things all because of the poor leadership that was coming from that particular manager at that time. And it's very, very common. And, you know, it's kind of funny. I think at this point, Kat, my wife, I think has learned the easiest way to make sure I do not get out of bed is to try to say, you know, hey, you need to get out of bed right now. That's the point where I'm like, okay, you know, I'm going to spend, I think, like 2 extra minutes in bed now. You know, if you start kind of going out after people in an aggressive way, an aggressive stance, saying, no, I'm the leader, this is how it's going to be done, it's not only going to alienate them and make them so they're not going to want to express themselves the way we want them to, but it's also going to build up that resentment to the point where they're going to actively be trying to sabotage you in a way. It might not seem like sabotage to them, but, you know, when you have a lot of people doing a lot of petty things left and right, that is, in a way, going to be sabotaging the business as a whole. So you have to be very careful about having either you or, of course, people that you appoint to leadership positions, you know, to not rule from that top-down approach, because if they do, that pettiness, that the, petty response that might come from that, it builds up and can really cause a lot of trouble just in a very short amount of time.
Well, here's the thing. Yeah, here's the thing that and Maxwell teaches us so much, so well, is that when you lead from position, people will lead, will follow you only because they have to, and they will only do as much as their job description requires and no more. They will not go the extra effort. When 5 o'clock gets there, I mean, they're out the door. They're not coming in early. They're not going to go the extra mile. They're not going to try to do, do the job with excellence. They're just going to do the very minimal they can when you try to lead from position. That's why in the mastermind group, as Stacy has said, we're going to be looking at a number of these other ways to positively influence people so that they will go the extra effort. They will go the extra mile for the leader, which will have a huge benefit for the whole organization. So that's why I'm really looking forward to this mastermind group. I think it's going to be very, very helpful to anybody who's in a leadership position.
James, when you said you got to follow me because, it made me think of the Margaret Thatcher quote. She said, being a leader is like being a lady. If you have to tell people you are one, you aren't.
That's right. That's exactly right. Yeah.
And for a more pop culture version of that, when Tywin Lannister yells at Joffrey, a person who says, I am the king is no true king.
Yeah.
So yeah. We can't go one entire webinar here without a nerd reference from James. So that, you got it
there. There you go. That's right.
If you could see this tech setup I have to make sure all this even partly runs, of course I'm going to make some nerd references here and there.
So one of the things that we're going to do in this mastermind is we're going to not only look at these, positive ways to influence, but we're going to actually get practical. How can we positively influence people? And so I'd encourage those listening, if you really want to take your influence and leadership to the next level, man, this is get on with us and join those others that are involved in this. And we're going to mastermind this topic, and it's going to be very, very helpful.
Yeah, I guess just to kind of close this out, we'll talk just a little bit about why, a little bit more on so we've kind of gotten the why. Let's talk about how we can increase our influence. So and let's just get into a couple of different ways here that are positive before we jump off. I hate to only talk about the negative way. And so one, obviously, as with John Maxwell as one of our big, huge mentors, we've got to talk a little bit about adding value to others and how that is an incredible way to influence others. And so what we teach and the way we try to live our lives is when we bring people onto our team, when we meet new people in other settings, every one of us, whether we like to admit it or not, we judge. And so you'll have somebody come in for an interview, let's say. Well, before they've even said a word, you've probably already put a grade on their head. If we're going to grade on a scale of 1 to 10, you've probably already decided whether they're 3, 4, 5, or 6 or whatever it is. And I'd be willing to bet there's a lot of times that after we've done that, we realize later on that we were wrong. But we all do that. And so this idea of adding value to others means we have to get better at actually placing value and feeling that others really do matter. And yes, so what I'm going to just implore you to do is, and again, especially in the business setting with your team, treat everyone as if they're a 10 and let them prove you wrong. Don't do the opposite. Don't go with that first judgment. What I see all the time is a team of people that are being treated like 3s and 4s. And if that's the way you treat people, that's really what they're going to do. They're going to be 3s and 4s. So we have to, I want you to empower them. I want you to give them more than maybe you think they're ready for, but definitely more than that what they think they're ready for. And by doing that, we actually add value. Now, sometimes it's from a place of goodness of our heart. We've got these things, and there's so many of us that struggle with delegation. And one of the reasons we struggle is I feel guilty giving this away. When in reality, what we could be doing is empowering someone else to learn a new skill, to learn a new task, to build themselves up instead of just hoarding everything to ourselves. So something as simple as a delegated task can be a way that we add value to others, but to our family, to our spouses, to our kids, our parents, our friends, our coworkers, every single day, our first thought should be, what can I do to add value to somebody that's important in my life today? And if you would follow that one simple rule, your ability to influence others is going to go up in a very positive way. And what do you guys think about adding value?
So I will say that, you know, I've seen a lot of companies do this, but I've seen also a lot of people not really care when doing this. They'll go up to an employee and ask them, you know, okay, so where do you want to be, you know, in like, you know, 2, 3, 4 years or whatever, you know, that basic question that a lot of us hear. You know, reality is that's a great question to actually really be asking someone who's an employee, right? Figure out kind of what are their ambitions and goals. The difference is, unlike what a lot of people do, unfortunately, you know, a lot of people, they don't really, they ask the question, but they don't care about the response. It's just a, oh, it's supposed to be kind of thing you're supposed to do. No, actually care about what their response is. Figure out what is their interest? What is their ambitions? What is it that they really desire and really want? And then try to help them get to that level. Like, actually take real steps. And that's going to take, of course, effort on your part. It's going to take, you know, time away from things that you might would rather be doing. But at the end of the day, helping build other people up, that will also help when it comes to things like you were saying before, delegation, right? You need to make sure that you can build up their confidence in such a way where they feel comfortable taking on these new tasks. And it starts with, to be honest, very small and simple things. You know, whether it be just a very small little bit of responsibility to add on top of what they're doing that they actually want to do that still pushes them towards that goal they've already let you know. So, you know, be careful when, of course, asking some of these, you know, standard questions that a lot of people ask their employees, be careful to not just ignore them. Actually really pay attention to what they have to say, because that will really make a huge impact on how they feel about you when they realize that you're on their side. You're on their side. You want them to succeed. It's not about, oh, I want you to help me. It's that, I know I want to help you. And that will make a massive difference going forward.
Yeah, you know, that's what adding value is. And it was what Zig Ziglar used to say, if you help people get what they want, they'll help you get what you want. You know, and adding value is simply just letting people know that you're there to help them get what they want to get, to reach their goals, to reach their full potential, to reach their vision. And as you help them do that, they're going to turn around and help you reach yours as well.
And I do want to add just one more thing to that too. Right now, it's easier than ever to add that value. I know we like to think sometimes that, like, right now is not like, you know, we're like right now we're distant, right? You know, we're on Zoom right now. We're all across the entire state of North Carolina at this point. We are from the coast all the way over to the mountains at this point of North Carolina. So it seems kind of weird to say now is the easiest time to, but also think about it. Right now, everyone is so distant from one another. Everyone is, you know, they don't really feel that connection with their friends anymore. You see it all the time on Facebook or Twitter or any of that stuff where people are posting stuff like, you know, I used to have all these friends and now I just don't really spend time with anyone. You know, people are desperate right now to feel valued. People are desperate right now to feel that someone out there actually cares about them. You know, now is actually the easiest time more than anything else to do. Just the smallest bit of goodwill to someone can go a much further way than it used to. You know, it used to be you had to sit there and go and buy them a full dinner and all this stuff and take them golfing and all sorts of stuff, which, don't get me wrong, I will gladly go golfing if anyone wants to ask me to. But if you do something even just as simple as it's their birthday, I'm going to send them a gift card and give them a phone call and say, hey, happy birthday. You know, really appreciate everything you do. Hey, here's a gift card for, you know, $10 for Starbucks. Very little things will go a long way in today's world, because let's face it, in today's world, a lot of people feel very isolated from everyone else around them.
Well, and it's the most connected world we've ever had and the most disconnected we've ever been as a people.
Yeah.
And it's so you're right. It doesn't take as much to stand out and add value to others as maybe it once did, but it doesn't mean it's easy, because it has to be very intentional. It has to be something that we put some effort into, and it needs to come from the right motivation. And so we can read right through if you're not doing this with the right heart. And so it has to be done from a really good place. But what the statistics will tell us is that there's an entire generation of people now who they just have lower self-esteem than what the previous generations have. And in our workplace, even right now, there's five generations of people that are trying to get along with each other, because there's still some builders that we're working with, and boomers and Xers and Gen Z and millennials.
Yep, that's right.
And now the alphas are coming up, and everybody has these different feelings. And so now, as a leader, it's getting even more difficult, because you got to manage all of these different expectations. And now, since we've had this pandemic, there's a huge expectation and a huge desire for flexibility. So we can't be the dinosaurs who just keeps leading and influencing the same way we always have. We have to learn to speak the right language to the people to whom we're speaking. We have to learn to exhibit and model the right behaviors. One of the most difficult things we'll ever do as a team leader or a business owner is to develop the culture that we want to develop. And your culture is absolutely essential to your success. The culture will make or break anything. And so, and it's very difficult to build a culture. And this idea of adding value and empowering others, that's one of the most powerful, impactful things you can possibly do to build the winning culture that you want to build.
And that's where, of course, also the importance of vision really is. Really in that role of leadership, if you really want to be able to influence people, there has to be something that everyone can kind of look to that will unify everyone around you. You mentioned how many generations are all together right now, and how many different people of all different backgrounds are coming together. In many ways, obviously, that's good. You know, we get a lot of different, you know, ideas and things like that from a wide variety of people. But at the same time, if there's not a central vision where all those ideas are going to, then you're going to have nothing but chaos, right? Even if all the ideas are somewhat good ideas, there's the idea of a, or that saying of the good idea fairy, you know, where too many good ideas, but not centralized to an actual vision, will just lead to nothing but disaster. So, you know, you in that position of influence, a big part of it is going to be having that vision that you can actually, you know, portray to everyone around you. So that way, everything that they're doing, you know, all their differences can actually be utilized towards one central goal. And that will help also, of course, build up that culture that you're talking about.
Yeah, and we're talking about all these different generations, and you're right, in the marketplace today, in the business place today, there are more generations working together than at any other time in our history. And with all the different ideologies and backgrounds that go with that. But here's the thing, a leader has to be able to influence all those generations. And if the key way to doing that, because there's one thing that every single generation will respond to, and it is this: do you care for me? Do you really care for me? If you really care for me and have my best interests at heart, I'll follow you anywhere. And so that's the ability to influence people. So it is tying that all together. So Stacy, why don't you wrap it up and bring us home?
Let's wrap it up. Let's give you something to do over the next 7 days. How about that? We'll give the crowd something to do over the next 7 days. If you want to be more productive, if you want to see some growth, we can sit here and talk about it till we're blue in the face. But knowledge is not power, regardless of what the TV told us all these years ago. Knowledge is not power. Applied knowledge is where the power is. So if you don't do something about it, and if you don't take action, then knowledge isn't really anything at all. So we're going to give you an action step to take. For the next 7 days, at the end of each day, I want you to set aside some time to reflect. We've talked in other videos. You can go back on our channel and see where we've talked about this idea that years of experience mean nothing if it's not evaluated experience. Right. So over the next 7 days, I want you to evaluate your daily experience and be very intentional. Focus it on, how am I influencing others? So the three questions I want you to ask is, with your ability and with your new attempts to influence others, what did I do right? What went wrong? And what am I going to do better tomorrow? Three questions every day. Spend just a few minutes in reflection each night. And the topic of this reflection is going to be, what did I do to add value to others and increase my influence with others? So this can be in your family, it can be in your church, it can be in your community, it can be at your work. What did I do right? what went wrong? What am I going to do to be better at this tomorrow? And so maybe the what am I going to do tomorrow? You're going to pick one person and you're just going to give them some words of encouragement that maybe they don't hear anywhere else in their life. Just imagine what an impact that might have. Maybe it's going to be someone that you know is struggling with a project and you're going to roll your sleeves up and jump in and help them get something done that maybe they're struggling with. Whatever it is, what went right? What went wrong? What am I going to do better? Do that for 7 days. And I assure you, when you come out of the other end, you're going to have a much better handle on influencing others and adding value to others and actually being a bright spot in the life of a lot of other people.
Yeah, absolutely.
Now, with that said, James is going to pop up a link for our mastermind. This mastermind study is coming up March the 7th, I believe, is the start date, March the 7th. And so what we're going to do is we're going to cover all 10 chapters of this book. If you join this mastermind, when you join this mastermind, what you're going to get is the ability to speak up. We don't just talk at you like we're doing here. We ask questions. We study together. If you come to a night and you're like, man, I feel kind of bad, I didn't read the book, that's perfectly okay. We guide the study and we open the discussion to everyone. So it's a great chance to learn with like-minded people, people who want to grow in their ability to lead and influence and grow their businesses, grow their personal and professional lives. And together, I promise you, if you come spend the 5 weeks with us, one day, one night a week, hour to an hour and a half a night, if you come spend that time, I can promise you, you'll come out the other side a stronger leader and better able to influence those around you. You guys got anything else to add?
Absolutely. Nope. Sounds good. Sounds good. We're just looking forward to it. Yep. It's going to be great.
Awesome. Thank you everyone for tuning in and watching. Really, really do appreciate it. Again, you know, if you do really enjoy this, hey, leave a like on the video, as well as of course, check out our YouTube page where everything gets posted as well. And make sure you subscribe for more content. Either way, you know, thank you so much for watching. Stacy, Billy, thank you so much for popping in as well. And Absolutely. We'll be talking again real soon. Thanks.